During the course of the Enlightenment from the middle of the 18th century, people started developing an interest for the geology of their environment. The Alps and Central Europe became an important focus of study with systematic research of the geological structure and mountain range formation. In 1758, Giovanni Arduino sketched out this geological profile of the Italian Alp foothills. Over time, studies from different locations were combined and a first impression of the structure of the Alps was obtained. The Alps represent a folded mountain range which arose from the collision of the tectonic plates of Africa and Eurasia. These folds can be seen in this longitudinal cross-sectional view through Switzerland from 1911. Here you can see how individual layers were almost vertically displaced. More recently, the methods of seismics were used to explore the deep structure of the Alps. In 1998 and 1999, a large-scale seismic survey was carried out in the eastern Alps. The project was called Transalp. Various seismic procedures were used for the measurement and evaluation of the data. One of them was wide-angle seismics. This uses reflections and refractions over very long distances. Hello and welcome. In this video, I will introduce you to the methods of wide-angle seismics using the example of the Transalp project. You will learn how a seismic wide-angle measurement is built up on land, and you will also learn what sources and receivers can be used. I will illustrate the benefits and disadvantages of longer compared to shorter seismic profiles and how areas of different depth can be studied. At the end, you will see how the combination of different seismic methods in the Transalp project produced new insights into the subsurface structure of the Alps. The Transalp project was an international and multidisciplinary research program to study the formation of the Alps. One aim was to investigate the collision zone between the African and European tectonic plates under the Eastern Alps. As you will see, a small tectonic plate under the Adriatic Sea has played a particularly important role. For this scientific project, geophysicists built up an almost 340-kilometer long reflection profile between Munich and Venice from north to south. This included the Eastern Alps and parts of its northern and southern foothills. The scientists initially carried out reflection seismic measurements with almost vertical ray paths over the entire profile. In addition, other geophysical and seismic methods were also used, including those of wide-angle seismics. Wide-angle seismics uses reflected and refracted waves recorded over large distances. For the reflected waves, wide, that means obtuse angles of incidence result, hence the name. The great distance between source and receiver, the offset, is of benefit if the average propagation velocity of seismic waves is to be determined in an extended rock layer. Such average velocities can then serve as a prerequisite for further analyses of the subsurface structure. Another application is the mapping of deep layer boundaries extending down to the crust mantle boundary. With wide-angle reflections, it is possible to depict layer boundaries that are not seen by vertical reflections, because they are concealed under strong reflectors. This is referred to as undershooting. In the Transalp project, the locations of such deep layer boundaries were to be determined. The specific questions which need to be answered were how and where the Adriatic and Eurasian plates met. For the investigation of the subsurface structure of the Alps, up to 53 component seismometers were used to record the data in the Alps. The instruments were placed at intervals of approximately 5 to 10 kilometers across the Eastern Alps. On the map, these are marked with green, blue and yellow stars. For the Transalp project, both explosions as well as vibrosized sources were used to produce the seismic waves depicted here as red dots. Vibrosized emissions are mainly used for measurements with smaller offsets in the upper earth layers. For this purpose, they emit sufficiently strong signals. However, with the large offset distances of wide-angle seismics, stronger explosions must be used as sources to achieve a sufficient signal strength. Then, deeper layers can be investigated, such as the middle and lower crust of the Earth. Vibrosized emissions are measurable up to a few tenths of kilometers from the source. Explosions, also referred to as shots, can be measured over 100 kilometers away. Another difference between explorations with small and large offsets is the frequency content. For short profiles, also called offsets, vibro-sized trucks can produce frequencies of up to 100 Hz or even more. For wide-angle measurements, lower frequencies of around 10 Hz are required. Low frequencies are less strongly attenuated and can therefore still be measured at even greater distances. The disadvantage of low frequencies is due to the longer wavelengths, which decreases the spatial resolution. Therefore, for studying large-scale and deeper structures such as the crust mantle boundary, natural earthquakes are also used. In contrast to artificial sources, one cannot set their strength, place and time of appearance in advance. Regardless of the type of seismic source, the waves are reflected or proceed as refracted waves along the layer boundaries. Both forms are used in wide-angle seismics. In this travel time diagram, you can see wave arrival times compared to the source receiver distance, or in other words, the offset. A layer of a higher velocity is overlain by one with a slower velocity. In the case of small offsets, the direct wave impacts first, which is shown here in blue. The travel time curve of the reflected wave appears as a curved hyperbola in brown and red. At the beginning, the waves arrive sometime after the direct wave. These are then the almost vertically reflected ray paths that are used in exploration seismics. The larger the offset is, the more the travel time curves of the direct and reflected waves resemble one another. Their travel times therefore become increasingly similar over large distances. From the critical distance, the reflected wave arrives alongside the refracted wave. This is also referred to as the head or Mintrop wave and is shown here in green. It propagates with a faster velocity along the layer boundary and overtakes the direct wave at a greater distance. The reflections that occur beyond the critical distance are termed hypercritical, with this being the area of wide-angle reflection. In the vicinity of the critical distance, the signal amplitudes of the wide-angle reflections are particularly large and relatively easy to observe. In general, vertical reflection seismics allow a precise depiction of relatively flat structures. Wide-angle reflection and refraction can deliver moderate velocities over larger distances and depict reflectors at great depth. Generally, one uses large offsets for wide-angle reflections. They are typically many times larger than the depth of the layer being studied. A rule of thumb is, for the investigation of deep reflectors, offsets of 4 to 5 times the investigation depth are necessary. For studying the crust mantle boundary, offsets of 100 to 150 kilometers are therefore necessary. In the Transalp project, these types of long profiles were used and combined with short profiles with more vertical ray paths. In the image, you can see a seismic profile that was recorded during the Transalp project. The shown profile represents the stacked seismograms from shots at one location, which was recorded at all the monitoring stations. This shot position is located in the north of the profile, south of Munich, and is marked with a red circle. The profile was filtered between 4 Hz and 40 Hz and was NMO corrected. The first wave arrivals at the various stations can be seen clearly in the profile. The PG-labeled phase is the direct, non-reflected wave that penetrated in the upper part of the Earth's crust to about 3 km in depth. The PMP-labeled phase represents the wave reflected at depth by the crust mantle boundary, in short referred to as MOHO. Here, the associated ray paths are shown, which are calculated using a velocity model. The red crosses in the seismic profile represent theoretical travel times that also result from the subsurface model. The match is very good on most of the traces. The second profile shows the recordings from shots fired near the Italian-Austrian border. Here, too, the subsurface model can easily explain the travel times. Two deep, strong reflectors in the north and the south can clearly be seen. Application of the modeled ray path allows the identification with high ray density and therefore good resolution. This last figure is a combination of shallow and wide-angle seismic measurements. The reflectors are interpreted as the location of the Eurasian Moho in the north and the Adriatic Moho in the south. The small Adriatic plate seems to be sliding over the Eurasian plate underneath the measurement profile. This is a result of the combined evaluation of shallow seismics and wide-angle seismics that was used here to capture an image of the tectonic plates in the subsurface. Just as in the middle of the 18th century, even today we are still interested in analyzing the deep subsurface structure under the Alps, as well as understanding the tectonic processes. As one example, there are indications that the Adriatic plate at another place is pushing under rather than over the Eurasian plate. As part of the AlpArray project, it is planned from 2016 to record local and global earthquakes over the entire Alpine region with approximately 300 permanent and more than 500 mobile seismometers. Using this data, a three-dimensional image of the subsurface of the entire Alps will be created for the first time in order to better understand the interactions between the continental plates. In this video, I have introduced you to the methods of wide-angle seismics. Both reflected and refracted waves are observed over long distances to allow a view of the crust mantle boundary. They complement measurements of vertically reflected waves that cover shallower depth. Using the example of the Transalp project, I have shown you how information about the structures in the Earth's crust can be obtained. For example, about the Adriatic plate, which in places appears to be shifting over the Eurasian plate due to the collision of Africa.